Coming up next, the story of an unlucky artist that bootstrapped from coast to coast trying to find his big break. But ironically, his breakthrough hit came from a spontaneous outburst that he shouted because he was so embarrassed by his own voice. So he actually dissed on himself as a joke. He kept it in the song, and the diss, it became a mantra for a generation. This song transformed the artist from a struggling wanderer into a sensation, you know, with his self-deprecating lyrics and his wild, erratic energy. We're gonna kill the headlights and put it in neutral. Coming up next on Professor of Rock. Hey, music junkies. Professor of Rock, always here to celebrate the greatest artists and the greatest songs of all time. You know, if you remember the rock cards or superstar music cards, you know, baseball cards for rockers, you're gonna dig this channel of deep musical nostalgia. I have actually have both sets. Make sure to subscribe below right now and click the bell so you always know when our latest interviews are dropping and our videos. We also have a Patreon. Check us out there. You'll find an additional catalog of exclusive content. You can become an honorary producer to help us curate this music history. So I'd like to start this little episode by telling you a story. It goes like this. In the time of chimpanzees, I was a monkey. Butane in my veins, and I'm out to cut the junkie with the plastic eyeballs, spray paint the vegetables, dog food stalls with the beefcake banios. Wait, what did I just say? Spray paint the vegetables, dog food stalls with the beefcake banios. Of course, I can't take credit for that bizarre passage. Those words were written as song lyrics by Beck David Hansen, the artist simply known as Beck, right? In his breakout hit Loser. How he came up with this classic song, it's insane. You gotta hear this story. Loser was the culmination of years of improv performances and DIY recordings by Beck. The rocky journey that led him to the day he collaborated with Carl Stevenson to record Loser included years of moving back and forth across the country. Along the way, he was often homeless, he was ignored, he was broke, working jobs that paid him less than minimum wage. Feeling like a total outcast, Beck dropped out of school after junior high, actually, before high school. He felt school was important, but he just didn't feel safe there. When he applied to the new performing arts high school in downtown LA, he was actually denied. His brother took him to post-beat jazz places in Echo Park and Silver Lake. He hung out at LA City College, looking at records and books and old sheet music in the college's library. He also had a natural streetwise ingenuity that helped him get into places that he wasn't authorized to be in. He mostly used his fake ID to sit in on classes at LA City College. Oh yeah, and he also befriended a literature instructor and his poet wife under false pretenses. Beck worked a string of menial jobs, including loading distributor trucks and operating a leaf blower. In 1989, with just $8 in his pocket and a beat-up guitar, Beck embarked on a journey to New York City. Now, despite his efforts to secure a job and some kind of housing, he just struggled to find success at all. However, his fortunes changed when he discovered Manhattan's Lower East Side and stumbled upon the tail end of the East Village's anti-folk scene's first wave. He immersed himself in this vibrant community. Beck became a part of a group of acoustic musicians that was led by Roger Manning. It also included Cindy Lee Berryhill, Kirk Kelly, Paleface, and Latch. Their unconventional approach and their determination to break away from acoustic mainstream music, that really resonated with Beck. He wanted to do the same thing. When he reflected on this period, Beck described it as a time when artists aimed to dismantle cliches and, you know, forge new paths. The communal atmosphere, that allowed performers to express themselves freely without fear of judgment or pressure. During the late 1980s and early 1990s, Beck found himself trudging through the New York City anti-folk scene while facing dire homelessness. By early 1991, financial hardships forced him to return to his hometown of Los Angeles. Beck's situation, it was dire, but he persevered. He took on low-wage jobs to make ends meet while performing his music at local coffee houses and small clubs. To capture the attention of jaded, disinterested audiences, Beck adopted a spontaneous and playful approach to his performances. You know, whenever he was faced with a crowd that was more focused on bar chatter than his music, he would veer into improvisational territory. He often crafted absurd and comedic songs on the spot. Loser emerged from this experimental spirit of Beck's stint in the Big Apple. It was an offshoot of his desire to see if his audience was truly engaged in what he was doing on stage. Influenced by the spontaneity of the local spoken word scene, Beck embraced this freedom by creating songs that really delved into the surreal and absurd aspects of everyday life, transforming mundane musings about pizza, MTV, and fast food jobs into whimsical compositions. Sharing living quarters with Pellface, Beck found a supportive ally in his roommate. He often slept on his couch and joined him for open mic nights to showcase their evolving artistry. But the truth is, Beck had no place else to go. He was either crashing on his buddy's sofa or he was going to live on the street. Now, eventually, Beck said, enough is enough, you know, with this transient lifestyle of a down-and-out musician. He faced the reality of another harsh New York City winter rapidly approaching, like I said, made that decision to move back to L.A. Reflecting on his hometown retreat, he expressed his exhaustion from the bitter cold and the challenge of homelessness, admitting, and he said, and I quote, it was hard to be in New York, you know, with no money and no place to live. I kind of used up all the friends that I had. Everyone on the scene got sick of Beck leeching off of him. He had to go back to L.A. and find something that could, you know, spark his career, give him something to go for. When he returned to L.A., Beck found himself back in the same old slum hole, though. The same one that he struggled in New York City. Beck found employment at a video store in the Silver Lake area, though. This is where his duties included dubious tasks like organizing the adult film section. Alongside his day job, he started performing at unconventional venues like Al's Bar and Raji's. He was aiming to develop a fan base of any kind. Beck recalled banging away on a tiny stage and the whole audience would be talking, just not paying any attention to him or his music. So maybe out of desperation or even boredom or the audience's indifference, Beck started to make up ridiculous songs just to get a rise from the crowd. He'd often come on stage as a mysterious figure to both the public and artists who crossed paths with him backstage. Sometimes Beck would spontaneously take the stage between acts at local clubs and deliver quirky folk tunes accompanied by what could only be described as abstract performance art. Beck would show up wearing a costume, or he'd put on a Star Wars stormtrooper mask on stage. Occasionally, he'd light things on fire and even break dance for added effect.
Staring at the child made of cheese and black sausage.
The bold antics worked, though, and Beck slowly began to generate a buzz in the L.A. underground. Now, while he played the underground club scene, Beck diligently crafted demos, embracing a fiercely DIY approach, do-it-yourself model. The music on Beck's demos were really raw and kind of unsettling and predominantly improvised, reflecting both the impulsive spirit of his live shows and his fondness for the truly absurd. In the late 80s and 90s, many artists recorded their demos onto cassette and passed them out as mixtapes at their live gigs. It was, you know, very common practice with ambitious rap and hip-hop artists. Beck did the same thing. Beck's avant-garde live show piqued the interest of Tom Rothrock, who had his own indie label, Bongload, with Rob Schnapp and Brad Lambert. Rothrock was riveted by Beck's performances, so he went backstage and he offered Beck a deal. He promised that he would have the opportunity to really be as unconventional as he wanted to be. Rothrock, for his part, truly spoke Beck's language. He was all in with Bongload. Such a funny name for a record label. So Tom Rothrock suggested that Beck play the rough draft of his songs for a guy named Carl Stevenson, who'd worked as a hip-hop producer for Rap-A-Lot Records in Houston, and now he had a home studio in L.A. It's basically a home studio with an 8-track tape recorder in his living room. Stevenson, who is also the creator of the indie alt-rock group Forest for the Trees, he found himself truly puzzled by the eclectic mix of folk rock and rap elements in Beck's material. However, he was intrigued by a slide guitar riff that Beck had included in his demos. So So he took that slide riff and he combined it with a looped drum track sample from the Johnny Jenkins cover of I Walk on Gilded Splinters by blues legend Dr. John. And he put some other samples that he had archived into the song as well. The musical arrangement morphed into Beck's sitar, and then a bass line, a tremolo guitar sample from Stevenson, and the aforementioned drum track sample. Stevenson's represented the revamped version of this song to Beck, and he listened to it over and over again. This new arrangement really inspired Beck to start an impromptu rap on the spot. He started channeling the energy of Public Enemy's Chuck D, somebody he really respected. Unfortunately, the outcome, it fell short of expectations, let's say. From the outset of their collaboration, Stevenson was not impressed with Beck's rapping. When Beck listened to his rapping on playback, he too was horrified. Said he thought he sounded like the worst rapper in the world. He elaborated with his self-criticism by declaring in disgust, saying, "I'm just a loser." Then Beck started singing, "I'm a loser, baby, so why don't you kill me?" So Beck and Stevenson decided to keep the self-deprecation on the track as the song's chorus. And then Beck added his gift for improv with a series of strange, nonsensical lyrics that have been described as folk rap. Beck recognized the influence of folk music on Loser. He noted, and I quote, he said, "I understood that folk music involves adapting tradition to reflect contemporary themes. I believe my folk music would resonate more if I infused it with hip-hop beats." Additionally, he drew parallels between Delta blues and hip-hop, which served as further inspiration for the song. Every verse on Loser is hellishly bizarre, especially when you've memorized the words and stopped to, you know, make some kind of sense of what you're singing along to. Let's get into it. The middle to end of verse one, for example, "Someone came in saying I'm insane to complain about a shotgun wedding and a stain on my shirt. Don't believe everything that you breathe. You get a parking violation and a maggot on your sleeve." So shave your face with some mace in the dark, saving all your food stamps and burning down the trailer park. Yo, cut it. So as we continue to break down these lyrics, I do want to thank our sponsor, Zenni Eye, with the glasses I always wear on here. Just click on our info button right up here to get the best prices on the prescription eyewear starting at just $6.95. You heard me right. Just under $7. Do it. You're going to love it. You can't make heads or tails of Beck's words. Don't even try. Just really, you let your imagination flow wild and free and enjoy not having to be logical for a change. Speaking of folk music, Beck's lyrics in Loser, they kind of remind me of some of the more curious lyrics that Bob Dylan wrote in many of his compositions. Voices of evil and a bozo nightmare. Ban all the music with a phony. To Curbs Neath Holes, Where Babies Wail, Though It Shadows Metal Badge. Where babies wail, though it shadows metal badge. Another Dylan gem from Murder Most Foul, "Wolfman, oh Wolfman, oh Wolfman Howl, rub-a-dub-dub, it's a murder most foul."
Rub-a-dub-dub, it's a murder most foul.
Now, for years, I didn't know exactly what Beck was saying in his pre-chorus. I later found out it was "Soy un perdedor," which is Spanish for "I'm a loser." I guess Beck learned some Spanish while growing up in a section of L.A. where many of his schoolmates were of Mexican descent. Further demonstrating his bilingual skills, Beck added some German in the chorus reprise with this line. So why don't you kill me? The sample of "I'm a driver, I'm a winner, things are gonna change soon, I can feel it," that's sourced from an independent film titled Kill the Moonlight. It's helmed by Beck's friend Steve Hanf.
I'm a driver, I'm a winner, things are gonna change, I can feel it.
Beck contributed some songs to that particular film, which wasn't released until 1994, a year after the song featured the sample was released. Hanf also directed the music video for Loser, Now, according to Beck and Stevens, the loser was basically finished in under 7 hours, except for two minor overdubs that happened a few months later. Following its recording, Beck initially found the song very interesting, but not particularly impressive, let's say. Reflecting on it later, he remarked, "The raps and vocals are all first takes. If I'd known the impact it was going to make, I would have put something a little more substantial in it." End of quote. However, the release of Loser as a single strained Beck's relationship with Stevenson. I guess Stevenson expressed regret over his involvement in creating the song, particularly citing the negative lyrics. He stated, "I feel bad about it. It's not Beck the person, it's the words. I just wish I could have been a more positive influence." So Loser was ready for prime time in 1993, but it sat around unnoticed for months. In the meantime, Beck was living in a rat-infested shed near an alleyway in L.A., still broke, still frustrated. Even though Beck thought his song was just mediocre, Tom Rothrock, he thought otherwise. At his insistence, Loser was released as a 12-inch single in late March. Now, only 500 copies were pressed, though. Beck was so due for a break at this point, he finally got one when Chris Derides, a Grammy-nominated air personality on NPR station KCRW in LA, started to play it on his popular show Morning Becomes Eclectic. Listeners, they responded immediately, and the enthusiasm then spread to the world-famous K-Rock and also to the End in Seattle. Loser climbed its way up the airplay charts all the way to number one on the alternative rock chart in 94, and it went to number 10 on the Billboard Hot 100, which is amazing. It's also a number one hit record in Norway and Scotland, went to number two in Iceland, number eight in Australia, and number 15 in the UK. Loser was the opening track on Beck's third studio album, Mellow Gold, that sold over 2 million units around the world. Feeling the pressure to constantly prove himself, Beck faced a harsh backlash with critics that labeled him as a self-indulgent phony and merely a product of marketing hype. By the summer of 94, Beck was in a state of struggle, with many of his peers questioning his direction. Despite the widespread popularity of Loser and its accompanying music video, Beck remained uncertain about the sustainability of his newfound fame. He feared that he might be relegated to the status of a one-hit wonder. During concerts, he experimented with eclectic musical styles, treating audiences to unexpected doses of reggae, Miles Davis, or jazz punk renditions of Loser. At festivals, Beck fully embraced avant-garde performance art, and with his bandmates engaging in shocking stunts such as setting fire to cymbals, playing guitars unconventionally, Beck even altered the lyrics of Loser to discourage sing-alongs, resulting in moments of confusion and laughter among the audience. Reflecting on that period, Beck recalled performing to bewildered faces and receiving reactions ranging from, you know, amusement to complete disbelief. Beck relished unpredictability, and his career uncertainty didn't last much longer after that, really. I mean, of course, he was not a one-hit wonder. Loser was the song that ignited a career that 14 studio albums in, numerous hit tracks, and admiration from his peers that came from all genres of music. Pop culture, it would have been used in a variety of films, but Beck has not granted permission to license this song. He denied the use of Loser for Dumb and Dumber. He denied a parody by Weird Al Yankovic as well that was going to be called Schmoozer. That would have been a lot of fun to sing along to. I'm a schmoozer, baby, so why don't you kill me? Beck expressed regret, though, after denying Weird Al permission to record that particular parody. Thinking back on the missed opportunity, Beck was really honest. He said, "I think it would have been an amazing video. I'm actually really sad it didn't happen." Also, author Stephen King, who is a huge music junkie, he mentioned the song in his 2017 novel that he co-wrote with his son Owen, Sleeping Beauties. In the book, the main character's son Jaredt refers to this song after getting the crap kicked out of him by three bullies. "I'm a loser," is what he thought. "That Beck song, it must have been written with me in mind." That was the quote. He may have been a terrible, horrible rapper, But Beck's clever, bizarre wordplay and his willingness to poke fun at himself propelled Beck David Hansen, the artist who slept on couches, cleaned yards, and filed video cassettes for years, to instant stardom. It's another one of those endearing stories of determination and just perseverance, conquering against the odds to become the eventual winner. It's not a glamorous process when things aren't going well. I mean, you might just feel like a loser, but if you really want it, you gotta be willing to go through hell and do whatever it takes to get it, even if you're a loser, baby.
Loser, baby, so why don't you kill me? Come on.
Thanks so much for watching. Leave us a comment about Beck and Loser. I remember the first time I heard this, I instantly went out and bought it. I had to know who this amazing artist was. Beck has had such an incredible career. Let's talk about it below. If there's other Beck songs you think we should cover on here, let me know. Maybe we can get an interview. Let us know. If you like our content, we invite you to subscribe below. Love to have you as part of our community. Until next time, three chords and the truth, my friends.